Good afternoon. My name is Ray Tsuchiyama. On a very windy, very rainy Monday in Honolulu, Hawaii. And to my left is my co-host, Russell Liu. And I want to welcome him and all the viewers with a Happy New Year of the Rooster.
Yes.
And we are going to be really delving into the world of the new year that started up throughout Asia and wherever they celebrate the New Year of the Rooster. And we're going to be talking first about a huge human phenomenon called returning home during
yes.
New Year.
And
Russell, what does this mean for China? And when does it start and when does this end, this great coming home?
Well, a short anecdotal note to this. I received a frantic phone call this week in Ray. It's a friend, he's here in Hawaii, saying, can you please help me? I have a family of friends, they're stuck in Shanghai. They can't get a flight to Beijing. They simply can't get a flight because the return flight back to Hawaii flies out of Beijing.
Right.
And I laughed yeah. because, you know, it's one of these things that if you don't live in China,
right.
you're not aware,
yeah.
it's the largest human migration right. in the world. It happens this time of the year. It happens on the first day of the lunar calendar for the Chinese New Year and the last day of the celebration when people are returning back
right.
to their homes. And, you know, it's a big phenomenon because everybody that works in the cities,
right.
they all have roots somewhere outside the cities. So they all have to go back home and they celebrate New Year and also the spring festivals. So, in fact, I was talking to some other colleagues in Beijing and they just returned back to work, to the offices yesterday. So this is the biggest migration in the world and it's estimated 3 billion people are on the move. So you can't get a ticket on planes.
So what did you tell your friends about them stranded in Shanghai?
Well, I said good luck. I don't think there's much you could do, but they didn't manage to find their way. And, you know, there are probably much more frequency of trains. So
right.
if you don't mind getting
right.
on the train,
right.
and it's still very hard to get a train ticket.
Right.
So what typically happens, I told them, go and buy the most expensive train ticket, first class. Buy your own train ticket, buy your own little caboose or sit in front. That's the best way
right.
to get back. And also, you know, they have now the bullet trains all over from Beijing, Shanghai. So I said to them, well, maybe everybody's on the bullet train. Try to get a first class ticket on the O train, the overnight train that goes from Shanghai to Beijing and Beijing, Shanghai. And they did find a ticket, so they were lucky, knock on wood.
Well, that's great. You know, 20 years ago when I started to visit China and so forth, this phenomenon really didn't exist. People did go home, but I think what you're talking about is that it's related to the economic development, the vitality, that there's a lot of migrant laborers, you know, in the
yes.
big cities. There's a lot of students who are in studying now and more in universities
base.
In Beijing, Shanghai, Guangdong. And also, there are special economic zones
yes.
like Shenzhen
yes.
that didn't exist 20 years ago.
Right.
And there are people from all over China working in special economic zones and really interacting with each other
uh-huh.
that didn't exist before.
Yes.
They were all, you know, 20, 30, 40 years ago, they used to be in their village for life.
Well, you know, the interesting thing about it, we go through a 20, 30 year period with the economic development of China, Ray, people have money, people
right.
moving to cities, people working in cities, special economic zones, and also you had your hookah card, so
right.
you had a restriction on travel. But now they've kind of done away with that. People can travel freely in China, local citizens. But the biggest impact, I think, that I've seen is because the economic rise of China, we're not just seeing travel in China. Many of the fluent Chinese or middle class will travel, they'll leave China,
right.
and they travel to the U.S. And we saw that here locally, and I'm going to tell you my observations that kind of astounds me to see this growth, this economic growth, it's spilling across borders, you know. We live in a world where there's no borders. And so this past weekend, I went to a celebration. It was put together by the Mainland Chinese Overseas Association. Now, this started about 20, 30 years ago, and my wife's a member of it. She's
right.
from China. And I used to feel bad because there are very few Mainland Chinese people here. They don't celebrate
right.
it. A very handful. But I went to this banquet. They had over 600 people. They
wow.
had to turn away people.
Wow.
This was the game in town.
Right.
This was the event that if you wanted to see how China has changed, its impact, they're all there at this celebration. Every table was filled. And they even brought an entertainer, famous entertainer from Beijing, who played music. So we're seeing that locally in our community. But greater, more so the impact is, I was at Ala Moana, and I saw that the Ala Moana Shopping Center on a Saturday brought out 20-something, 28 line dance clubs.
That's correct. Yeah. I was there.
And you were there, okay? Yeah. So you saw that. So they went around. They did the traditional line dance at all the vendors to wish them good luck.
Right.
Following that week, we saw in Waikiki a similar show of line dance clubs all over Waikiki. So we're seeing something that is the impact of the economic growth of China. It's spilling across borders, which gets into our topic that we're going to talk about, you know, our trade policy, so forth.
Now, you bring up a very good point, because traditionally, when we talked about the Chinese in Hawaii, they came from one area, which was in the south, the Guangdong area, and they migrated here from, you know, the middle of the 19th century. The Chinese were in the plantations, they're working, they were in trade, and so forth. And even as late as the 50s and 60s, it was more or less concentrated in Chinatown through the Guangdong, you know, kind of schools, and it was heavily Cantonese, the language. And now you have quite a rise in people from the mainland who are Mandarin speakers,
yes.
Am I correct? So language is a big change from just 20, 30 years ago. And the other is culturally, they're coming from bigger cities that usually did not see them before, from Beijing, Shanghai, so forth, in Hawaii. Now, these people who attended the big celebration, would you say they're you know, business people? Are they students? Are they, you know, tourists? What kind of mix are they?
Well, it's a very interesting question, Ray. I think the first thing you raise is language. And, you know, I'm amazed because previously, 20, 30 years ago, you only heard Cantonese.
Right.
And most of them were more labor type,
right,
from Cheongsan,
right,
traditionally where they had ties with the Chinese here.
Right.
But now it's Mandarin. I'm going to Safeway, nice Safeway.
Right.
I hear Mandarin spoken. I go everywhere, hear Mandarin.
Right.
And it's amazing that we're seeing a shift, you know, with the shift of people, shift of humans coming here. That means a shift of capital, you know, that's coming here, money that's coming here.
And even, you know, as a child, when I heard the words Gung Yi Fa Choi, I thought that meant Happy New Year in Chinese, but of course that's Cantonese.
Yeah, so it's now Xin Yi Kuai La, which is the Mandarin way. So we're seeing more and more money coming from not the traditional old generational ties, places like Cheongsan. We're seeing, Cheongsan is really not a big city, okay?
Right.
But we're seeing coming from Beijing, Wuhan, and I just had a meeting the other day with a Chinese developer who got his green card, I understand, from the EB-5 program. He's done some hotels in California through the EB-5 program, finding investors from China. He's had one successful project that closed out near the Makaloa area, near Don Quixote, and by Walmart, and he's doing another development with EB-5, and he even has a showroom in Waikiki Shopping Plaza, and he's not only bringing Chinese money, he's bringing Japanese and Korean investors who want to invest in the U.S. So he's from Wuhan, so we're seeing
Wuhan. That's a city that, you know, of course, is an industrial city,
yes,
you know, in the middle part of China. So that's a name that, you know, I used to know very much, but it's not a name that would resonate, you know, 20, 30 years ago.
Yes.
Nobody, you would never meet a person from Wuhan.
You would think, where did this person come from?
Right.
Exactly.
Right.
And so we're seeing that, you know, and you know, we're seeing more influence, and he is coming to this town and developing, bringing money, you know, so we're seeing a different kind of Chinese now, but we're seeing the effects of a global world. More and more fluent Chinese are coming here, investing money.
So back to the dinner, I just wanted you to comment, you know, what was the makeup of the people? You just said that there was that a profile of a business person, an entrepreneur, you know, coming out, like a first generation coming out,
yes,
and then really going, you know, full speed ahead on projects, real estate, and so forth. So are they all real estate connected? Are they going to be going into other areas? areas that Hawaii really needs, like high tech or you know, products for exporting back to Asia? What do you think?
Well, you know what I think? It's weird. The first wave of investment is going to be really real estate, because that's the first basis of wealth for Chinese, having property real estate. I think for this economy, we're not so much business friendly as maybe in other states. We don't have heavy manufacturing.
Right.
We don't have Silicon Valley, but I'm hoping that if the real estate, they come in here, it's higher capital, high end capital, but if the state realizes that, you know, you have a really interesting network of people, you're having Mark Zuckerberg, who is a favorite in China now.
Right.
Making his home in Kauai.
Right.
We need to better network these opportunities. The Chinese will come, but we need to figure ways. We need to diversify our economy. That gets to me another point, so this is part of it, is the economic part of aspect of Hawaii. And the fact is that, you know, tourism, we could depend on that at one time, but the many destinations around the world being developed with internet, the Chinese were the biggest travel group, tourism group, and spend the most money. They're finding other places, not only Hawaii. The other aspect is that, you know, with that, the Chinese are starting to look at investing other places. San Francisco has a great program to attract the Chinese investors. The Silicon Valley is moving into the city. But again, these are new industries that we should look at. You know, with computers today, internet, you can work just about any place in the world. It's how we pick and choose.
Well, you're right about, you know, within China itself, that if you saw the types of industries, the top 100 billionaires, mm-hmm. many of them are in real estate, like mm-hmm. Wanda, for example,
yes.
Dalian. But others are in the companies that we think of more as Chinese, like the Huawei's, the Hires, the Lenovo's, you know, more high-tech kind of mm-hmm. companies. But they're the brands that are coming out to the U.S., and we're not really seeing what the great investments in mixed use or commercial developments are happening in Shanghai, Beijing, and mm-hmm. other cities. And I think what's they're really working hard and getting that experience within China and then going outside to cities. But you're correct that there are other cities like San Francisco or Seattle or LA or the West Coast or even Las Vegas that's really really promoting their cities for investment by Chinese and really rolling out the red carpet. So we are, of course, a tourist destination. Nation, but how can we make that one more level for an investment?
Well, I think what we have to look at our core strength there, Ray. One of the core strengths that we have here, we're an Asian culture city, so there's a comfort zone. Like the Japanese travelers that became investors, we welcome that. So we should do the same with the Chinese. But what I think is important is that we don't have a Harvard here. We don't have an MIT, but we have great preparatory education, college preparatory education. Marital School, for example, has now come out with an immersion program for the Chinese language. We're seeing, of course, Pono has a World Center. Iolani School has the Innovation Center, which is very, very key.
And we'll go back and delve more into the role of preparatory education in attracting investment or as part of a whole strategy in 1 minute.
This is Jane Sugimura. I'm the co-host for Condo Insider, and we're on ThinkTech Hawaii every Thursday at 3 o'clock, and we're here to talk about condominium living and issues that affect condominium residents and owners, and I hope you'll join us every week on Thursday. Aloha.
Aloha, this is Keili'i Akina with the weekly E Hana Kakou, Let's Work Together program on the ThinkTech Hawaii Broadcast Network, Mondays at 2 o'clock p.m. Movers and shakers and great ideas. Join us. We'll see you then. Aloha.
Hello, my name is Crystal. Let me tell you, my talk show, I'm all about health. It's healthy to talk about sex. It's healthy to talk about things that people don't talk about. It's healthy to discuss things that you think are unhealthy because you need to talk about it. So I welcome you to watch Quok Talk and engage in some provocative discussions on things that do relate to healthy issues and have a well-balanced attitude in life. Join me.
Welcome back to ThinkTech Asia, and we are talking about rolling out the red carpet for investors from China. And Russell was just talking about, before the break, on the role of preparatory education to really be part of our strategy to create a comfortable investment climate for Chinese entrepreneurs. And you were talking about Iolani, Marino, Punahou, all kinds of schools are now doing immersion programs mm-hmm. in Mandarin, cultivating relationships so that there's more children coming mm-hmm. and their tiger moms maybe be mm-hmm. maybe in the same neighborhood, as part of the families that are coming to stay with them or at least support them when mm-hmm. they're in school. Now, this whole preparatory education part, has it just grown like organically, or is there some kind of strategy in mind?
Well, Ray, I've been in Beijing for 13, 14 years, and I also teach at law schools, and I teach university students. And what I've seen is that the growth is because China had a going out policy in 2001. They want the Chinese companies to go out, establish themselves outside the Western world. Very important because, to get to the next level, like the U.S., in the 1930s, we had the growth of the multinationals. We had Coca-Cola, we had IBM. All that wouldn't be possible without education. And the buzzwords in China is innovation. It's very hard in a Chinese system because there's so many few seats for students in college, good colleges. You're talking about Beijing University, all the good schools. So the other thing is that the Chinese started a language policy over 30, 40 years ago with students in the primary school level starting to learn English as a core requirement. So they have this English language thing. The Chinese government knew that the language of business is English. So fast forward now, Chinese companies need to go outside. They need human resource. They need the capacity ability and the capability of human resources to take the Chinese companies to the next level so they can have middle management and upper management. So the role of the education is very important. So now parents are starting to see that, and they send their kids out from high college level. Now it's high school. Now it's middle school. And I'll give a little anecdote. I've been contacted by groups to help them to bring kids here. What they want to do is they want to have some English learning classes. They'll come here during the summer. And they want to have time with American students to practice their English. And guess the age of the kids? Why don't you take a guess?
Oh. 8, 9, 10 years old?
No, kindergarten. So you know where I'm coming from, where I'm saying, wow, this is an opportunity for Hawaii to build an educational industry, travel industry, where they come with their moms, they bring the kindergarten kids, and until they grow up, you've got good 15 years for them to come back every year, starting educational programs.
And of course, there's so much clean air and a great environment
here. Well, clean air and another thing, knock on wood, they're less and less going to Europe because of the terroristic things. And so this becomes a very ideal place. We have direct flights. We need more hotel rooms. But again, these are things that it's a special niche. So with that comes people who have money, children, and they get to mix with our kids. And possibly, if we plan this right, at somewhere along the line, we need to, in our high school system, have more innovation centers like the one at Iolani School, where Chinese kids can come for the summer or the holidays, learn the English, and do some innovation projects. And these are great things that we can capitalize on.
So. Well, education is a great export market when you think about it, because it's not polluting, it's knowledge-based, and we have great teachers, many, many teachers throughout Hawaii. But we're talking about the new year, and also during the last week, there's been developments with the new president and, mm-hmm. and the whole Asian region. There was a visit by Defense Secretary Mattis to South Korea and Japan, and also interactions with China. Before that, at Davos, Xi Jinping having a great reception there as a world kind of leader at that conference. What is the view from China dealing with, as we spent 2 weeks now, mm-hmm. 2 weeks with the new administration, any signs that the governments in Asia Asia are responding or reacting mm-hmm. in certain ways?
Well, I think for the governments in Asia, we talk about Korea and Japan, Vietnam, all these countries, Singapore, you know, they're taking a very cautious attitude because remember, China's in the backyard, big trading partner. South Korea's biggest trading partner is China. It's a big trading partner with Japan. So there's a delicate balance there. But I think we've got to go back to prior to the election, prior to President Trump. And we have to remember, he accused China of manipulating his currency. He accused that China was stealing the jobs away, that he's going to slap a 45% tariff on all Chinese goods. We had also the TPP looming.
Right, right.
So,
which the U.S. under the new administration is not really exploring
right,
anymore.
Which has scrapped it. But what does this mean for China? Well, China has been planning ahead with this. It's been forging ties closer to Central South America. It plans to build a massive railway for goods to be moved across Latin America so that China can move things from both oceans across. And so there's a lot of things going on, but the really key turning point, you talk about Davos. This was China's stage. And President Xi Jinping stated something that I think was no surprise. He says, we support free trade. We support globalization. And he said that China's gonna do everything it can to promote trade and investment, liberalization. His reasoning was that many of the problems troubling the world today is not caused by economic globalization, he said, because whether you like it or not, globalization is the big ocean you cannot escape from. Because with internet, everybody sees things, everybody has knowledge. So goods are moved freely across borders. So we've come to a new age where in China's whole thing is they welcome President Trump because he is, believe it or not, he is putting China on the stage now. We're going to see alliances shifting. We're going to see countries having to choose. And now Europe is going to get closer to China with President Trump's announcement that we're not going to support NATO, the financial end of it. So again, all this is playing to the hands of Chinese. That means that they become center stage. That means that this is going to be the catalyst for them to be a global leader more so. And so again, these are things that validates Xi Jinping's power in China. He's going to be there for a while. So all of these things are making China actually much more relevant and much more important in today's world.
In the symbolic area that the defense secretary chose South Korea and Japan as first countries to visit, I think does reflect a strong feeling within the administration that it has to bolster those relationships. And now one place that's been quiet recently is North Korea. And of course, China has kind of a supportive role in with North Korea, as I think China is the only friend it has. but it has been quiet. And that's South Korea and both Japan are really, really sensitive to any North Korean missile launches and so forth. The other place that, of course, China is sensitive on the other side is THAAD, the high-altitude radar missile network in South Korea, that they see as looking into China, looking into, you know, way into Chinese space. So again, the first visits were more of a security kind of symbolic impetus from the Trump administration, not trade. Mm-hmm. However, everything that China has been doing has been about trade, has been about economics for the region. So, but you're correct that things are still being formulated, still being discussed. There's going to be a lot more, discussions as we go forward. But it's interesting that, you know, there has been already an ambassador named for the U.S. side going to Beijing, the governor from the Midwest. And I think that's a sign that Trump considers a very strong person in Beijing to really work with the Xi Jinping government.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think that's a good observation about having someone from the Midwest, because remember, that's what carried President Trump the elections, the Midwest, the key states, blue states. But I think you have to take a look and understand the Chinese culture and history. Thousands of years, it has really not gotten into wars outside of the borders, except for the Korean War. It's been a nation that it has a long-standing civilization, education much more important, economy, the money is more important. And the military analysis say that not to 2030 will China be able to catch up with the U.S.'s military. So I think China understands that. And if you look with the liberal policy for Chinese students to go abroad, you have 750,000 students that are going to college in the U.S. So what are they doing? They're actually building a capacity. They're building a human resource capacity and capability so that they can take the Chinese companies outside of China and to manage the Chinese companies. And that's the key to where the Chinese are headed, not militarily, more economics. So again, with Trump's presidency, I think China's happy because it's time for them now to go center stage. It's time for them to advance globalization economic policies. With Europe afraid of Putin, who better to have on your side?
Well, and going back to your point about middle managers and so forth, the thing about Japan right now is that it's being criticized for not creating jobs in the U.S. And so there's been a great program by Abe and others to really send the SoftBank, President Son, others. But also there was the head of Alibaba in the U.S. talking about new jobs.
Yes.
So there is also another line that China is going to be working on to create plants and manufacturing and new jobs in particularly in the Midwest.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
For Americans to be employed by Chinese companies or investors in that
right.
region.
And you're right. We talked about a previous show about Fuyao Glass, the largest automotive glass company, and they decided to bring the glass industry to the U.S., the auto industry. And the Chinese are very smart because I used to be with a Midwest law firm. It's their Beijing office. And you know, the day would come, I said that, you know, the Chinese are going to come to the Midwest and they're going to create jobs. And I used to fly back and flights between the Midwest and Beijing. I would be astounded by a number of engineers that were going from China to the Midwest to work on programs, and really they're building the human capacity, the technical, the middle management. I see kids also, young kids, this is 10 years ago, they would send them a month in Ohio at some school for language. So again, it's interesting how China takes a more of a long-term viewpoint,
right.
Very pragmatic. And I think Japan is doing the right thing, but I think for Japan, I think what they need to do to speed up the curve is a language capability, because you know, when it comes down to it, understanding culture and language, you know, is a key.
And perhaps, like you said, for a college, for the high school, even going into kindergarten, maybe this should be a reciprocal program for Hawaii children to go to Wuhan and Beijing, Shanghai,
Guangdong,
and study there, and then, you know, get immersed in Chinese culture and language and become employed by investors in Hawaii.
Yes, and that, yeah. that's what will allow investors to come here, seeing that you have language capability. And that's very important, because when you have language capability, it opens the doors to investors.